rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 20 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. Now, if you've been listening to this show for any amount of time, you know that about every fifth episode or so, I try to do a solo cast where I share my thought leadership with you as opposed to having on a guest. Well, we're not going to do that today because today is a special day. Today is a special day, not just any day. Okay, that's enough of that. I won't torture you with any more what passes for my singing. That's that old school tone. Y'all young bucks, y'all don't know nothing about that there. But all jokes aside, today is a very special day because today's guest is a dynamic communicator herself, Jill Schiefelbein. Jill is an award-winning entrepreneur, author, and recovering academic. She taught business communication at Arizona State University for 11 years before venturing into entrepreneurship. Jill's business, the Dynamic Communicator, helps organizations increase sales and create consumer advocates. Jill runs the Dynamic Accelerator program, helping solo and micro entrepreneurs accelerate business growth. Her new book, Dynamic Communication, 27 Strategies to Grow, Lead, and Manage Your Business, hits stores today. That's right. That's why we're doing this today, this very day. So if you're listening to the sound of my voice, that means Jill's new book is available right now. You got to go out and get it. So without further ado, let's get into our interview with Jill Schiefelbein. Jill, thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks for having me, Timmy.
I started listening to the National Speakers Association podcast after hooking up with our mutual friend, Phil Gerbershack. Excuse me. And you have your segment, Jill's Juicy Bites. And I must say, I'm a big fan and I do not impress easily when it comes to that type of stuff. But you really bring a lot of value. And so I'm very excited to be talking to you because you have a new book coming out today, the day this launches, called Dynamic Communication, Strategies to Grow, Lead, and Manage Your Business. So, you know, you have a breadth of experience most people will crawl over broken glass to get to, but nobody starts at the top of the mountain. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and how did you become enchanted with marketing?
All right. So if we're going to go on this mountain climb, we need to make sure we have adequate provisions, food, water, you know, that type of stuff. Right. So let's strap in and get ready. So this, you know, this book has been an amazing journey. And I'll really go back a long way and say, for me, my love for words, you know, which evolved into my love of what I now know as the more formal study of communication, really evolved when I was in high school. I was told, I'm from a very small town in Kansas, and I was told by my parents that if I ever wanted to go out of state for college, which I wanted to leave Kansas, that was my goal. And it's nothing against Kansas. It just wasn't right for me at that time. Mm-hmm. And I said, so I need to get out of here. They said, well, you need to get a full ride scholarship somewhere. So what did Nerd Jill do? Nerd Jill went to the library and researched what the heck that meant and then did everything in her power to get said scholarship achieved, ended up going to Arizona State. That's how I got there. But in that process, I started speaking publicly. I was taking on big leadership roles. I started traveling around the state and even in my senior year traveling around the country, talking about community service, leadership, and the importance of giving back. And in that time period, I fell in love with words because, to be quite honest with you, I got intoxicated. I would get up on a stage, I would say things, and then people would do things. To me, that was power, and that was intoxicating. So that's where the love of words originally came from. If you want to go way, way back to when I was packing my supplies, that's it.
Awesome. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but, you know, sometimes on this journey, it's kind of like marriage, right? You fall in love, they can do no wrong, then you find out that this person snores like a dime moose and farts and does all this other stuff. So when did that sort of shiny veneer come off and it was time to get down to brass tacks?
You know, what's interesting for me is I don't know that shine. I'm one of those weird people who went to college for the degree that I actually ended up getting. So I don't know that the shine of that wore off, but I'll tell you, it switched courses for me. So me, I thought I was going to be this motivational speaker and leadership conference facilitator. That was my goal going into college. And I do speak publicly and I do get paid to speak. So that part's not far off, but I ended up in school taking a lot of different classes, getting a second certification in international business alongside my degree. And I fell in love with communication in the business environment. And I'm glad that I gave myself that opportunity to take classes outside of kind of what I thought I was going to be doing, because the business aspect is where, for me, the strategy comes in. And while I'm an educator to the core, I taught at a university for 11 years. I wrote the textbook. I did all that higher ed academic stuff. But what frustrated me about it is it wasn't always applied. And so when I figured out I could actually apply this knowledge in business, that's at that point is when I switched from an educator to an entrepreneur.
Awesome. Awesome. So if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
You know, honestly, if I could go back and quote unquote do it over again, number one, I would have done more internships. I did one internship, and at the time, I will be honest, I was a little gripey about it. I wasn't too happy about it. It was an unpaid thing. It was a commission-based sales thing. I learned that, wow, sales as a career is not my thing, even though, ironically, as an entrepreneur, you're selling yourself all the time. Right. But from that, I actually got to see, in my case, a very awesome women-owned small business owner, and see what she built and see how she managed her staff just by observation. And I think people put a lot of pressure on a single internship, but I would actually go back and have multiple internships. That's number one. Number two, I would actually have diversified the education that I did get. I'm, you know, degree in communication and international business, great. If I could go back in time, knowing the world how it is now, I would go back and get a computer programming degree as well. That would be something that, for me, I love understanding the root of problems. So I was always that kid in math class when they said, here, do this, and here's how you do logarithmic functions or whatever in the calculator. I'm the nerd who raised my hand and asked, that's fine, but what if I'm somewhere and I don't have a calculator? I need to understand the fundamental formula that goes into it. And I would get looked at as weird most of the time. But for me, if you can understand the backbone of anything, if you can understand the rules of a system, then you can use your unique expertise and skill set to excel within that system. But so many people don't take the time to know the backbones. They want the shortcut. So I would really focus on other educational opportunities and classes that could have helped me understand the system and the backbone better.
I dig that. I tend to agree. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future, because one of the great things about the time we live in now is that we're talking about mobile and connected devices and the Internet of Things, and sort of the pat example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk, then automatically adds it to your shopping list, and then it gets delivered to your house via Amazon drone, right? So in that scenario, it's what they call a closed loop system, because you don't have to actually leave your house. So there's been questions asked, though, but okay, what's the role of marketing in that environment? Because, you know, the milk has to get in the refrigerator in the first place, right? So what is your take? Put on your future glasses. Okay, once things become automated and we live in the Jetsons, how will marketing evolve?
Marketing, the most effective marketing is currently, will be, and always has been, in my opinion, if you really trace the roots on it, based on human experience. Uh-huh. And what we tend to get away from when technology comes into the equation is, since now we can scale and now we can do things in a bigger, more amplified arena, sometimes we tend to overlook those essential elements of personalized human experience. And what marketers, I think, in the future and even now need to really be cognizant of is that even though you're able to use technologies to reach mass people, even though you're able to use specific retargeting pixels on Facebook ads to only hit, you know, women at the age of 35 living in New York City who have a cat and who have visited your website before, meaning me, you really need to be able to, when you do get to that person, make that marketing a personalized experience for them. One of the things I say in the book, not to be completely self-promotional, but it's important here, is that so many people look at communication, they look at marketing as really these kind of terms that flow out in isolation, and they're really part of a bigger system. And so to me, when people think of, you know, good communication skills, they're thinking of, I know how to write a grammatically correct sentence. I can go and give a presentation without using ums or us and stand perfectly straight. I'm able to write a message that is so well crafted. It makes sense with this beautiful, you know, storyline throughout it, whatever it is. But here's the deal. Good communication skills are not enough. You need, yes, I'm going to be corny here, dynamic communication. And dynamic communication to me is communication that focuses on results and actions that derive from you communicating to others. And so it's not about, did I stutter? Oops, well, I'm not a dynamic communicator. No, I can slur my words. I can make a mistake. I can accidentally cough into the microphone. I can stumble on stage. I can make a small grammatical error. I'm not saying be sloppy with your writing, but one tiny error, if you are giving someone an experience with your communication, is not going to impact the outcome. If anything, it makes you more human. And that's what I think we need to focus on now and in the future, is not losing sight of, just because we can scale and just because we can be kind of stalkery, creepy, and target people now, doesn't mean that we shouldn't cater to them as an individual in terms of how they need to experience marketing materials.
I knew there was a reason I liked you. I'm over here taking notes. So, you, Gary V, and Brian Solis, or, you know, insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference. You're at the bar chilling after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from today's generation of marketers, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
I think there's a certain element of transparency that's lacking. And that's one of the things, the people who follow me know without question that I am to a fault transparent. I will tell you the dollars I spent and what my return was. I will tell you the biggest mistakes I made, the biggest time waste I've had. I will tell people, I mean, this last week in particular, I have been down and out because of a severe lower back injury. So I wasn't able to travel this week, but on live streams to followers, you know, I talk about that type of thing. And it's the realities about the business. And I think what happens is people, again, you have this impression of what you need to be, what you need to come off as. And while people, especially in the younger generation, which I am liking that trend, are like, I am unapologetically, authentically me, you know, and F anyone else, there's a balance in there. There is being you, and then there's also being completely transparent about it and not just always having this is me, but really taking time to think through and analyze things. And I think we're lacking that in a lot of things today because we see a lot of these get-rich-quick schemes. And I'm sorry, I don't care how brilliant you are and what level of success you've gotten at, you can't tell me that you can tell me how to create a six-figure revenue stream every month when I don't have 40,000 followers already. Right. That's not the reality. The reality is you need to spend years building up your follower base if you want to do it in an authentic and non-gimmicky way. And then once you reach that base, these are some strategies that you can use to blow it out of the water. And that's really what it comes down to. That's really, you know, the transparency. And I wish more people would go back to their roots and say, listen, this is how ugly it was when I started out and I worked through it. And oftentimes people breeze over those stories because when people hire them to speak, when they've reached a certain level of success, they want the meat of what's going on now. But the really important thing is going back to the roots and understanding the beginnings, and especially the environment in which they began. a little monologue here, I know, but professional speakers, for example, that started their career 20 years ago before the internet was really even a thing, had very different sales and marketing strategies than people who are trying to make a business getting paid to speak in our world today. And so those are apples and oranges in comparison. The strategies aren't the same. So we really need to understand not only the roots of when things happened, but the time and place in which they occurred.
Too true. Very, very sage advice. So we are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Jill Schiefelbein. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left them bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Jill, this has been tremendous. So I'm going to throw you a curveball.
Give me that curveball.
Without getting political, but by all means express yourself. Candor is the whole point of the conversation. What's your take on the whole fake news controversy / crackdown? And just to backtrack for anybody listening, in the last 3 months of the 2016 presidential election, fake news started to outperform real news on Facebook. And by fake news, we mean these stories were wholesale fabricated, had no factual basis in reality. They were completely made up. And, you know, they were deceiving people. So this has sparked a whole kind of conversation in the industry. You have some people that go straight First Amendment. You know, Facebook is a platform only. They have no business trying to be arbiter of truth. And other people are like, well, Facebook is a digital property. And as a digital property owner, you are ultimately responsible for what goes on your property. It's no different than, let's say, you have a pool in your backyard. I don't know that you do. And you're away on business and some knucklehead kids hop your fence to go skinny dipping and one of them drowns. Well, you put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. Happened on your property. You're responsible. So where do you stand on this whole sort of fake news hubbub?
Oh boy, you know what's going to happen right now is I'm going to have to put on the former professor hat on for a minute. Are you cool with that?
Good with it. Let's go.
So if you've been studying this fake news stuff, and what's funny now is academic stuff is finally coming into the media, but what I find sad is there's not too many academics actually capitalizing on it, which is, for me, why I left the university, is because it was all theoretical. And when there's actually a real reason to chime in, people aren't doing it in mass. And the big thing is cognitive bias. And what I love about this now is cognitive bias is now a term in the mainstream solely because, and not solely because, but in large part due to this past election, where how could we have gotten it all wrong? Well, the algorithms and the technology that want us to stay on their sites longer because they make revenue on ads the longer we stay on their sites are giving us things that we want to consume, that we want to read. So it's either giving us something that is the complete polar opposite of what our indicated beliefs are based on what we've clicked on and proclaimed before, so we get enraged and stay around, or it's giving us stuff that confirms those beliefs. And that's known as confirmation bias, is that we tend to see in our world, you know, what we want. It's just like if you've ever been shopping for a car and you decide that you really want a specific Mazda, for example, and all of a sudden you start seeing these dang cars everywhere. It's because you are really actively looking to see those where you weren't looking before. That's a really subtle example of confirmation bias. It's the same thing. In this past election, if you were one side or the other, you were looking for reasons to confirm your position. And that's why that type of news is so popular. But it goes even bigger than that. And it's really part of a theory. And one of the things that I love to do, and this was my passion for education, is theories are taught in schools in a way that make you memorize them and regurgitate them for a test. And I wanted people to understand with this book and with everything I do, how these fundamental theories actually do make an impact in what we see and experience in the world. And one of those, and there's a chapter about it, not even about it, with it, in the book called Cognitive Dissonance. Have you heard of this one before?
I have.
Yeah. So for those of you out there who haven't, now you're going to be able to like rock star cite this stuff and be super smart. But this guy by the name of Festinger came up with this theory that helps people explain what they do to not experience dissonance, which is basically this mental discomfort that you feel. And so the study originated where he was studying people in a suicide cult who really thought the world was absolutely going to end, and they prepped for the end of the world and they bought into this. And then when the world, in fact, didn't end, what they did to explain what happened, and those who really believe to their core cite the reason for it not ending as because of all of our prayers and all of our actions and our willingness to sacrifice our lives, that's why the world didn't end. For those who weren't too believing in it, they were like, yeah, you know what? It didn't happen. And they just go to move on. And then there are people on the opposite end, of course. But we do whatever we can to not only confirm our positions in life, but to be comfortable and confident with those positions. So we will actively seek evidence to support and make excuses for our support. So that's why even now you see a lot of Trump supporters who, when a lot of people, and in fact, the majority of people, both Democratic and Republican, are against a certain thing, there are still people that are clinging hard and either ignoring that reality or citing other studies, including fake news, or now we know alternative facts, to be able to justify that position in the first place and justify why they voted for that person in the first place. And that's all about really getting you at a state of mental rest.
That's deep. You got new terms, cognitive dissonance, confirmation bias. I hope y'all been taking notes because, you know, folks charge for this. But okay. So large corporations have just recently began to put some real muscle behind digital marketing. They don't attack it as aggressively as they do traditional marketing, but there was a time for a long time where corporations were starting to, you know, treat digital marketing and social media in particular kind of like a fad. And now that it's become very clear that it's not going to blow over, some corporations are starting to have departments where before they didn't. But what's starting to happen is that ad spend is disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. And there has been this theory posited on the Marketing Companion podcast by Todd Webster and Mark Schaefer that you may have a situation in the near future where you kind of have the haves and the have-nots in terms of digital marketing, because as more corporations put more corporate dollars into the ad spend, of course, that pushes the price up and that, you know, pushes the smaller players out. Do you see that happening, or do you think that the internet will stay open and free regardless of how many corporate dollars flow into it?
I can see the corporate dollars flowing in. That's no question. But I believe that the major platforms that exist today are not stupid enough to allow the corporate dollars to take the monopoly over it, because they know that the small businesses that are out there are the ones that truly engage with it. And if they fail to let them engage in that space, that's a mass of the population that may and is capable of creating alternative spaces. And I'm not saying, you know, someone's going to go out there and take over Facebook in, you know, the span of a year, but there are people actively looking for the next big thing. And if these current players give them a reason to go to that next big thing, then they have it. I mean, look what happened to MySpace. Look what is happening to Twitter. And even though now people are on it mainly to see what our current president is or is not tweeting on any given day, it is still one of the fastest declining social media platforms. So look at those and see where people are going. That migration is important to note. What's interesting about the corporate side, though, is that they're still in the majority of businesses years behind in terms of what is actually influential. It's the smaller businesses with budgets, but people who are hired to specifically focus on digital innovation, in my opinion, and from what I observe, that are really kicking it off. Yeah, you have a couple corporate behemoths that are super, super smart about it. But then you look at companies like Avocados from Mexico. They have to take every message that they have, and it has to be regulated by U.S. governing agencies, because they're actually just a marketing arm for produce, an avocado. But they were the top two campaign in the Super Bowl in terms of the digital conversation space the last 3 years. A tiny little company, because they have brilliant people there who actually understand, and there's not as much red tape for them to go up in a big corporation chain, and they're willing to take risks. So I see that, not necessarily the dollars, but smart innovations like that taking hold. I think Facebook, Google, they would all be shooting themselves in the foot if advertising got too out of hand price-wise. There's definitely this kind of curvilinear effect to it that when it peaks, it won't be able to go any higher. So they're going to have to find that balance to where they can get the money out of corporate, but they also can still extract that money from small businesses.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day. And I do appreciate your time. Been a real trooper, got a back injury and everything. I wish everybody was like you. So I'm going to take a moment to set this question up. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. But I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it, because in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or a brand or works at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship. Somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level, that ain't who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And in terms of educating oneself, there's sort of three traditional paths. The first is to roll the dice on Google. But there's absolutely no guarantees that you land on something credible. You could land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like who knows? You could do what I did, which is go back and get a degree specific to internet marketing. Problem with that is it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 from my undergraduate. Plus, it's time consuming. Even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. By far, the more popular way of educating oneself and disseminating best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. Problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's less expensive than a degree, you have to have the money up front. So some of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or Social Media Marketing World or MozCon, you're looking at $500 to $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food. Nope, just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all that other stuff back in, you're looking at between $3,000 to $5,000 out of pocket. And so a lot of people get priced out of that. So I'm trying to sort of crowdsource a way to professionalize oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or coming out a pocket a few stacks for a conference, which a lot of people just aren't in a position to do. So now that I've just rambled for however many minutes, the actual question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Jill. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
But I am a college freshman enrolled in a program, correct?
Correct.
In that case, one of the things that college students fail to do all the time, and admittedly, I failed to do it. This is one of those pieces of advice I would go back and give myself. You have a card in your pocket when you are enrolled at a university, at a college, when you're a college student, you have a card in your pocket that as soon as you graduate goes away. You have the student card, and this is the ultimate card. The number one thing I would do is I would research at the current institution I'm at, the Alumni Association. That would be my first start. I would see people who are working in companies or in fields similar to what I'm interested in, and I would get in touch with them and ask them if it would be possible to have a web conversation or meet them in person on campus, since you could use a meal plan on campus if they're in local areas, and just see if they would have 15 to 30 minutes of their time to talk to you about how they got to where they got and what they think you should focus on while you're at that institution, because no one knows better what to do at that institution than someone who's been there. So that's the first thing I would do. The next thing I would do is I would look at the space I want to be in, and I would find people who I feel would be the most amazing mentors in that space. And I would get in touch with them. I would write them and write them and write them. And you're going to get a lot of no's, but you're going to get some yeses. And again, being able to play the college student card is massive. Play it and play it well, because most people, especially if they're in corporations tend to hire people with degrees. And it's not because they say, oh my gosh, a college degree is the most important thing in the world, or it's the only way you can be successful. They know it's not, but it shows that you are capable of setting a goal, following a path, and then achieving that. And that skill set is what's important. And that's why a degree for most companies is a barrier to entry, because they want to know that you're capable of doing that before they spend time and invest time in you. Because when you're hired by a company, they're going to put time and effort into training you. They want to know that you're able to follow through with that training. So I would play that college student card right away. The next thing I would do, and this is a huge long answer, and I'll just stop after this, to make money, I would immediately find a way to use the skills that I do have in a simple way that doesn't detract completely from my studies, but in fact complements them. I would find what my current assignments are. A lot of assignments you need to get case studies, and I would find companies. I would first reach out to alumni that need that type of analysis done, and I would do it for them. And after it's done, come back to them and say, so I just did this. What other type of work can we agree on to help fund not only my education, but improve your company at the same time, and work my way into getting internships there to learn firsthand.
Fire, 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 folks. Jill, this has been tremendous. Thank you so much. Please take a moment to tell us about your new book coming out today. Get that, folks. It's hot off the presses. And give us all your social media profiles, any upcoming, you know, if you're going to be at any conferences, where can we get some more of you?
Well, number one, I'm everywhere on social at Dynamic Jill. It's so much easier than my last name, just Dynamic Jill. You can find me everywhere on that. The book, oh my God, I'm so excited. excited about it. This is, you know, it's like I've never had a child, but I imagine if I did, it would feel, you know, a fraction of this, because obviously having a child would feel a million times better. But this is the closest I've gotten in my life. So this book is birthed today. It's Dynamic Communication, 27 Strategies to Grow, Lead, and Manage Your Business. It's from Entrepreneur Press, the same guys that publish Entrepreneur Magazine. I'm very fortunate to have a nice, a big publisher with some clout behind me on this. And the book is designed so that no matter what problem or challenge you're facing, whether it's growth, whether it's management, whether it's leadership, you can literally get the book, open to a specific chapter, search the table of contents. I try to be very, very descriptive. Find the chapter that fits the problem that you're having, open it up, read it. Each chapter is, I think the longest chapter is about 12 pages. Intentionally, maybe 12 to 15 pages. Intentionally, you open it up, you can read that chapter, you can get a strategy, and you can go back. This book to me is one of those things you keep on your shelf as a reference when you need a new idea or a new strategy or something's not working. You can't manage your virtual teams well. Your people aren't taking feedback the right way. You need to get a video strategy for marketing. You need to understand webinars and how you can sell them better. You need to understand customer service or sales ideas, public speaking, whatever communication challenge it is. There's a chapter in this book, and you can use it as a reference guide whenever those problems arise. And you just have to read one chapter at a time. You don't have to read the whole book cover to cover to get value from it. And that's what's important. I don't want to force information on you that's not going to help you now. I want to solve your problem now and then give you a resource for the future. And that is available Amazon, Barnes & Noble, IndieBook, iBook, I mean, all over the place. And more information is at dynamiccommunicationbook.com, where you can actually sign up to get a free peek of it if you want.
DynamicCommunicationBook.com. Get that, folks. You want that. You need that. This interview has been oozing with value, and the book is just bursting with it. So, Jill, thank you so much for your time.
Thanks so much for having me.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.